كثر رايات أشاهدها تعلق ناسنا راية العباس هي اللي تحرك إحساسنا بيها خوة ووفاء وبيها رفعت راسنا بيها مقياس البطولة وأصبحت مقياسنا بيها صارت مثل غيرتك شانت حاجي الدهر صورتك.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هل أنت على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا إنا خلقنا الإنسان من نطفة أمشاج نبتليه فجعلناه سميعا بصيرا إنا هديناه السبيل إما شاكرا وإما كفورا إنا أعتدنا للكافرين سلاسلا وأغلالا وسعيرا إن الأبرار يشربون من كأس كان مزاجها كافورا عينا يشرب بها عباد الله يفجرونها تفجيرا يوفون بالنذر ويخافون يوما كان شره مستطيرا ويطعمون الطعام على حبه مسكينا ويتيما وأسيرا إنما نطعمكم لوجه الله لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا إنا نخاف من ربنا يوما عبوسا قمطريرا فوقاهم الله شر ذلك اليوم ولقاهم نظرة وسرورا صدق الله العلي العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فوضوا أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل ونعم المولى ونعم النصير. والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على الرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد، الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وعلى أهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله أنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. وقل رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتاب الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، إن الدين عند الله الإسلام. My respected elders, brothers and sisters in Iman across the globe, Salamun alaikum jamian wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Question: how powerful is your belief? When we look at our world and our institutions around our world and the individuals around our world, this concept of belief emerges. And it is something that is very important to the world at large and to you as followers of the Ahlul Bayt in particular. In fact, this belief is so strong and so powerful that it may perhaps guide every aspect of our lives. Whether this belief is in religion or whether this belief is not in religion. And so the question I want to explore with you in the brief moments that we have together is, how powerful is my belief and what impact does that belief have on my life? When we come to the nights of the commemoration of Sayyid al-Shuhada, Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, and the movement of Imam al-Hussein, and the remembrance of Karbala and Ashura, one element that emerges is the system of belief that was taught to us by the Imam. But it's important to notice and recognize that that movement, that mission of the Imam, is not separated from the mission of the other Imams, nor is it separated from the mission of Rasulullah, the Holy Prophet himself. But I want to look at and understand what was the linkages amongst these different belief systems by first understanding belief in and of itself and how important it is. When one believes something and when one does not believe something, how can that influence every aspect of the individual's life? Therefore, I want to look at what is belief and what impact does it have in our lives on a day-to-day level, on a year-to-year level, and throughout a lifetime. What is the example of the roots and the branches, and how does it relate to you and I as individuals? What was the example of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam and their relationship to belief, and how is it different than you and I, and what lessons can you and I get from the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam system of belief? What does science and modern science say about this phenomenon of belief, and what can we understand from it? And finally, at the fifth level, what was the belief of Sayyid al-Shuhada and his comrades, his companions, his holy household on that moment where they were about to depart from their home, from Medina, towards the land of Iraq? These are our five stages of analysis for this brief discussion that we have together. From the bottom of your heart, wherever you may be across the globe, send a salawat on Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli. The first element and the first component of the question that we are asking as individuals here is the question that has to do with what is belief and what is the power of belief. That in tashayyu, as followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, as followers of Ali ibn Abi Talib, as followers of Hassan al-Mujtaba, as followers of Hussein al-Sayyid al-Shuhada, as followers of all of the Aimma, the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, following in the line of Rasulullah, and ultimately culminating in the divine guides and following in their manhaj, we realize that this power of the belief of this household, of the holy household, is such that it has shaken and it has actually moved the chairs and the thrones of the tyrants. Although the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam themselves may not have had all the glitz and the glamour, they may not have all of the material wealth, they may not have had the palaces that the others had, but there was something that they had, and their followers had by consequence of their following the Ahlul Bayt that shook the throne of the mightiest of tyrants. What was that? That throughout century after century, after Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, or during the time of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, after Rasulullah, during the time of the first Imam and the second Imam and every Imam thereafter, there was heavy persecution towards the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. No, there's even persecution on top of persecution for the Ahlul Bayt themselves. Whether that is Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, whether that is Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, whether that is Imam Sayyid al-Shuhada, whether that is all of the Imams thereafter. Even the oppression that took place on Imam al-Baqir, and Imam al-Sadiq, and Imam al-Kadhim, and Imam al-Ridha, all the way, every single Imam. Whether they were imprisoned, or whether they were the heir apparent of the ruler. Everyone was oppressed because their right was usurped. Therefore, what is it that puts such a fear in the hearts and minds of people that they are afraid of the Ahlul Bayt, not only in their life, but they're even afraid after their death, that people are willing to demolish and desecrate their shrines, one after the other? What power is in these personalities that people fear them, and they fear even their graves? Otherwise, why would you fear someone's grave? It is the power of belief. Therefore, what is this concept and this philosophy of the roots and the branches? That what is this? I come from a part of the world where they have palm trees. And in these palm trees, you will find that they grow very tall. You will find these, for example, in the Middle East. You will find these throughout, for example, California. You will find these throughout hot climates in the world. These palm trees often grow very tall and they grow very high. Yet also where I come from, they have hurricanes. And hurricanes, they began to gather strength over the bodies of water. They began to gather strength over the oceans. And they began to increase in the wind speeds, ultimately culminating with fast winds that are over the water and the seas. And these same fast winds begin to make landfall. When they begin to make landfall, they cause, if the speeds are fast enough, they cause destruction on the land. They actually lead to these same palm trees that I mentioned to you a moment ago to be uprooted, lifted out of the floor, out of the earth, and taken across the town. And after the hurricane has moved on, and in the wake of the hurricane, you will find that the tree, the palm tree that was on one side of the town, ends up on the other side of the town. Albeit it's very tall. Albeit it looks like it's very mighty. But at the same time, you will find there are other bushes, smaller trees and shrubs, which during that same hurricane of the fast winds is strongly planted into the ground. And when the hurricane comes, it does nothing to move that except perhaps ruffle the leaves. How is that possible? What is going on here? That at one level you have the palm tree, it's going across town. And at the other level you have this shrub, this bush that is not moving very far. When you ask the experts in the field of botany, those who know the plants, who knows the palm trees, who know the bushes, they'll tell you straight away that palm tree, although it's very tall and looks like it has so much above the surface, below the surface in the ground, those roots may not be the strongest. Those roots that go into the ground may not go the furthest. And therefore, that wind that comes with the hurricane can lift and uproot that palm tree and take it across town. And yet at the same time, that bush, that shrub that is very short and not very tall, it's not moved. Because its roots go deep into the ground. They go sometimes for meter upon meter. And not only do they go down horizontally, vertically down, they go horizontally and they go for a wide distance. Although you may not see with your eyes. This is the example of the concepts of belief that our scholars have divided and from the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, that there are the Usuluddin and the Furu'uddin. That is the principle, that is those foundational elements. The Tawheed, the Adala of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Nubuwa, the concept of Nubuwa, the concept of Imama, the concept of Qiyamah. The Usuluddin, these are the roots of the faith. And at the other level you have the Furu', the branches of the faith. That is those, the Ahkam, the actions that you and I do. That is, those things that we implement in our lives. that have to do with our salah, our sawm, our all those elements of tawalli and tabarri, amr bil ma'roof, nahi anil munkar, and the likes, and hajj and all the likes that you are aware of. But when we come to our scholars, when it is the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, there has been so much emphasis on this concept of usuluddin, that is the belief. Yes, I am to, and I should, and I must follow the maraji in the school of thought in terms of the rulings with respect to the furu'uddin. But in terms of usul, in terms of my belief system, in terms of what I believe and why I believe it, and what's my dalil and istidlal, each and every individual must have their own proof and evidence. Each individual must know why I believe what I believe. Why is it that I believe in Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What's my dalil? What's my proof and what's my evidence? Why do I believe in the adala of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the absolute justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do I believe in the nubuwa, the prophethood, the concept of, and the philosophy of prophethood? Why imama? Why guidance? Why vicegerency? And why do I believe in the day of recompense, Yawm al-Qiyamah? Why? I must have I cannot go in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say on these issues, that is, Tawheed, Adala, Nabuwa, Imama, Qiyamah, these things, that I say I did taqleed of such and such, mujtahid. Yes, I may perhaps get guidance from the righteous scholars on what they have written in the books from the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam and the proofs that they have highlighted. But that must sit with tranquility and with certainty in my heart and my mind, and I must accept it with proof and logic and all the things that go with it. And this is why there has been such an emphasis on the belief system. And it is that belief that you will find is so powerful within tashayyu, within the school of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, that tyrant after tyrant, not only in the time of the Ahlul Bayt, even afterwards in the Ottoman era, if you go to the likes of Afghanistan, in times in history, in Lebanon, and what has happened when invaders came in those locations, when you look at the history of tashayyu, persecution after persecution has taken place. Why? Because of the power of tashayyu. But I want to remind you that tashayyu, Shiism, is strong when it rises and when it sits. That's the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. And as Rasulullah says, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn imaman qama aw qa'da. That the Al-Hasan wal-Husayn are imams, whether they are standing or whether they are sitting. It's important to remember that the stand of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam is equivalent to the stand of Hassan al-Mujtaba, his old elder brother. And the stand of Hassan al-Mujtaba is equivalent to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Imam Hassan in the place of Imam Hussein would have done exactly what Imam Hussein did. And Imam Hussein alayhi salam in the place of Imam Hassan would have done exactly what Imam Hassan alayhi salam did. What is the power of belief? We are told, come with me into the 7th year of Hijrah. We are told that 7 years after the migration, there is a moment in time where the Muslims are at a battlefield, where the Muslims are at a particular battlefield, and one after the other, the enemy on the other side is taunting the Muslims and saying, come to me and fight me. And on the other side, the Muslims are not able to bring victory. The Muslims are not able to bring the flag until a moment comes. And what a momentous moment. Well, Rasulullah, Rasulullah Adam, he makes the statement that tomorrow I will give the flag. It has been day after day. 39 days have passed. 40 days are approaching. That Rasulullah says, tomorrow I will give to the flag to the one who is a man who is brave, unrelenting, unretreat. He will not retreat. He will only advance and he will bring victory. That he will be an individual who will bring, who will only advance, he will not be retreating, and he will bring victory. I will give that man, I will give that person the flag. He is someone who Allah and His Messenger love, and it is someone who He loves Allah and His Messenger. The Muslims spent the night awake, and they were hoping that tomorrow I will give that flag. Why? Because Rasulullah has declared at such a high level, and he has declared with such strength and so clearly in front of all of the people to see that that person who will give the flag is an honorable person. Not only an honorable person, he is given the stamp of approval that Allah and His Messenger love him, and he loves Allah and His Messenger. What else could one want? What honor, what prestige, what dignity? They all said and they all thought that tomorrow I hope and I wish and I pray that I'm the one who gets the flag. When the day broke, at that moment in time, Rasulullah calls out and he says, where is Ali? Where is Ali ibn Abi Talib? They say, Ya Rasulullah, he's in Medina, he's not come. He has an ailment in his eye. At that point in time, we are told Rasulullah calls upon Amir al-Mu'mineen. And through this miracle of Imamah and this miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he emerges and Rasulullah, he cleanses his eye with his blessed saliva. And we are told that Ali ibn Abi Talib sees in a way he has never seen. Of course, this is for you and I to understand that they know from the divine leadership. They are appointed divinely. Nonetheless, Ali ibn Abi Talib, all of the hopes and the aspirations of the Muslims dwindled when they saw the face of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He advanced, and he advanced in such a way that he struck Marhab, and he destroyed him, and he finished him off, the one who was taunting, and he brought victory for the Muslims at Khaybar, and he lifts this gate of Khaybar, a gate which they say hundreds of men, some say 700 men would lift, that it was a ton upon ton. This individual, Ali ibn Abi Talib, with his two fingers raises Khaybar away, a fort, the door of a fort, which so many people needed to come together to lift. He lifts it with two fingers. But I tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, this same Ali ibn Abi Talib, the one who brought victory, the one who brought honor, the one who brought courage for the Muslims, come, he is now in the city some time later, and he is in the city and he is trying to break some barley bread. This dry barley bread, the simple bread that Ali ibn Abi Talib would eat. You want to know leadership? You want to know divine leadership? You want to know the manhaj of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, the leadership of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam? Ayatullah Wahid al-Khurasani, may Allah protect him, he says with respect to Ali ibn Abi Talib, that when he would sit down to eat, he would eat the most humblest of meals. That when he goes to the home of his daughter before the night he is struck in Ramadan, in Shahr Ramadan, before he's assassinated, he says to his daughter, when she puts two items on the plate, in front of him, on the place where he's eating, where there is bread and some yogurt and some salt, he says, when have you seen your father eat more than one thing at the meal? And she wanted that he drinks the milk. And she said, she began to take away the salt. He says, leave the salt, take away the dairy. At that point in time, this Ali ibn Abi Talib, he's saying, when have you seen? That is in an entire lifetime. When have you seen your father eat more than this? That what is the reason that Ali ibn Abi Talib would eat so humbly? And so he says beautifully, Ayatul Wahid al-Khurasani, that Ali ibn Abi Talib says, I have a wish, I have a desire. Ya Ali, what is your desire? What is Ali's desire and what is my desire? What is Ali's desire and what is our desire? We want the mansion, we want the car, we want the prestige, we want the wealth, we want everything. What does Ali ibn Abi Talib say? He says, I have one wish and that desire amongst my desires is that I meet my Lord in a state where my stomach is empty. Allahu Akbar. Where my stomach is empty. This is the state in which I want to meet my Lord. That Ali ibn Abi Talib, Ayatullah Wahid al-Khurasani continues, that in his entire dominion, why this simplicity as a leader of the Muslim Ummah? After so many years where he is leading in a place where he is leading Yemen, the domain of the Muslims has spread all the way down to Yemen and Yamama on one side, to Damascus and Syria on the other side, to Egypt all the way to Iraq. It is such a dominion that Ali ibn Abi Talib says, I do not wish that there is a single table spread. There is not a single family that has sat down to eat in this entire dominion. Except that I have the most humble food in the entire land. Nobody should be able to complain to the Lord on the Day of Judgment that Ali was eating lavishly while I was eating nothing. No one could complain. This was Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Ali ibn Abi Talib at Khaybar, remember this scene. And Ali ibn Abi Talib in the city at another moment, he is trying to break barley bread and he is struggling. He is taking his knees, we are told, to try to break the barley bread. They say, Ya Ali, Ya Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, You are the one who lifted the gate of Khaybar with two fingers, the one that it took man after man to lift. And you are struggling now to lift break this barley bread? How? He said, I did not, and remember history writes, I did not lift this gate of Khaybar with the power of my body. La, he says, no, it was not that. He says, with what then, Ya Ali, did you lift it? He said, I lifted this with taqat al-rawhaniya. I lifted this with the strength of my spirit, with the strength of my ruh. I lifted this gate of Khaybar. The power of the belief of Ali ibn Abi Talib, where he's saying it's not these physical hands, it's the belief in my heart that allows me to lift this. Now, what is the belief of Ali and what is my belief? It should be noted here that Ali ibn Abi Talib is Imam al-Muttaqeen. He is Mazharul Ajaib. He is the divine representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. That for you and I to say that we have this ability or capability of Ali ibn Abi Talib is beyond possibility. That is, the Imam is at a higher level, no doubt. The Imam is at an exalted level. The Imam is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no doubt. If we cannot get to the Imam, we cannot. But the question you and I must ask is, what about in terms of my belief? Can I get close to the dust of the feet of Salman? Can I get close to the dust under the feet of Abu Dharr in terms of belief? That they were the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib in the truest sense. Can I get close to that? Can I get in close proximity to that in belief? And if I get close to that belief, then where and what? What skies and what horizons can it take you and I towards? I say this because we live in a time, in a world where modern psychology has come forward and allowed us to understand the power of belief in our lives, whether we realize it or whether we do not realize it. A study conducted at Harvard University looked at the power of belief in one's life. Harvard, a renowned institution which is respected by people in the East and in the West. Harvard University researchers there conducted a study and they wanted to see what is the power of belief. So they went to a series of hotels. And when they went to these hotels, they noticed the staff that worked at the hotels. When they noticed the staff that worked at the hotels, they realized that the staff that was responsible for taking care of the rooms and making sure everything was appropriate, these individuals came forward and they would, for example, make the beds, or they would move the trolley, and they would, for example, go up the elevators, or for example, at times they would have to go up and down stairs and take things, they would have to hold towels, all of these physical activities. And they would do this one after the other. But as time progressed, they asked these individuals who worked in these hotels and were part of the staff of maintaining the rooms, mostly women, that is it and do you believe that the work that you do is exercise? They said no. They said very interesting. So the researchers divided the groups into two. One group, they told them that the work you do, carry on doing the work that you do. The other group, and they asked the first group that, do you believe what you do is exercise? They said no. Because the researchers had understood that the work, making the bed, moving the trolley, going up the stairs, holding the towels, weights, all of this was actually equivalent to exercise. Yet, they realized they didn't believe it, or they didn't know about it at least. So one group, they told them nothing. They said carry on as is. The second group, they told them and they put in their workplace where they work, they put signs and they actually showed images equating the work that they do with physical exercise. So for example, you making the bed and lifting the sheet is equal to this exercise. You going up the stairs is equal to this. You pushing the trolley is equal to this exercise. You, for example, holding heavy weights or towels and whatever you are holding, that is equal to this exercise. And they put this into the office where they work, the break room, if you will. And they said that what you are doing is actually exercise. And they tracked the results week after week, month after month. And the results were astonishing. Before they conducted the study, they also took the biometrics of the individuals, of the staff. They said, what is their blood index? What is their BMI? What is their cholesterol level? What is their blood sugar level? What are all of those key elements of their physiology and their health and their well-being? And they found that at that point in time, the first group, which carried on as is normal, although all of their work and their efforts were the same, their index, there was no improvement in their health. The second group, who was shown and told that this is the exercise that corresponds to the work that you're doing, and was told that the work that you're actually doing is not just work, it's actually physical exercise, that group saw that there was an improvement in their physiology, their physical being, their health improved, their heart rate improved, their blood sugar levels improved, every metric of their health improved. But here's the question, what changed? What changed? And the researchers say that the action was the same on both sides. The only thing that changed was the belief in the mind. That one group believed what they were doing was exercise, and the other believed it was not so, or did not make that connection. That's how much impact belief has, not only on our actions, on our physical body and our health and our well-being. Further than this, a well-documented phenomenon known as the Pygmalion effect, named after a play by George Bernard Shaw. George Bernard Shaw is one of the founders of the London School of Economics, a very famous playwright from the United Kingdom, who has written a play called The Pygmalion. Pygmalion is about a young lady who is moved from a socially economically low environment, not the richest environment of town, and moved into an aristocratic and a very wealthy part of town. And the adaptation that she begins to adapt to that environment, that is the name of the Pygmalion effect, based on this play. By the way, George Bernard Shaw is that individual and that person who actually studied Rasulullah. And he says that far from being the Antichrist, he is an individual that must be hailed as the savior of humanity. George Bernard Shaw's words, not mine. That if Muhammad were to be able to take the dictatorship of Europe, he would lead it to salvation. Not my words, his words. That this was someone who had truly studied Rasulullah and understood what Rasulullah was leading towards and how he was uplifting society. This individual, the Pygmalion effect. What does this? This is the theory based on the play. But the science is what I want to share with you. That the researchers conducted the study, which became known as the Pygmalion effect or the Rosenthal effect. What happened here? The researchers, Rosenthal, he had in his lab, he had rats and he wanted to study, is there any impact on belief, for example, and how these rats function in society? So what did they do? They put two buckets or two groups of rats. Now, bear with me and understand the power of belief here. They put in one group, one box, they put these lab rats, and they put on it written that these are intelligent rats. And on the second bucket, they put on this slow rats, dull rats, not bright, not smart. And when they put these two categorizations of the rats, at that point in time, we're told then they invited students or researchers into the lab without telling them, and they gave them one bag. They give one box to one group and they gave another box of rats to the other group. The first group sees intelligent rats. The other group sees dull rats. And their goal and their task was to lead these rats through a maze. To lead these rats through a maze. So for example, you start at the beginning, you open the gate, and you allow the rat to run through the maze, and then you time, using a stopwatch, how fast or how long does it take for the rat to emerge on the other side. And both groups were doing this. So the first group, timing. The second group, timing. One is bright rats, one is dull rats. One is smart rats, one is dumb rats. One is unintelligent rats. And so these two groups are operating. Now, what did the research show? The research showed that time after time again, the rats that had been written on their bucket, they would finish the maze much faster. They finished the maze much quicker. It took them less time. They finished much quicker. The dull rats, it took them longer to go through the maze. But what was the catch? The catch was that all of the rats were same. They were exactly the same. There was no difference. The list and the label that was written on the box was totally arbitrary. They could have been swapped, it would have been the same thing. So what changed? the researchers realized the only thing that changed was the belief in the mind of the people who were leading the particular rats through the maze. That is, the people who are observing, the people who are timing, the people who are interacting with the rats, their belief system changed. That's the only thing that changed. So once this was implemented on rats, the natural progression was to test this on human beings. Did this have any impact on human beings? And the research was phenomenal. It was implemented in schools in the Bay Area, we're told, in California, in the United States, that they approached the school system and the school district, and they told the teachers in the school district that there are certain students in your classroom, there are certain students who are in your class, we have tested this. They administered a test, and they gave them a test. And they said, as per the results of this test, certain students in your class, they are gifted, they are talented, they are extraordinary. And they said, you are not to let them know, you are not to tell them. And they identified these students for the teacher only. And there were other students who they let them carry on as is. At the end of the year, they found that those students in the school district who had been identified as gifted, who had been identified as talented, who had been identified as exceptional students based on the test results, they did much better in every aspect of their education. They did better on tests. They did better in their homework. They did better in everything. But what was the catch? The catch was all of the students were the same. The Pygmalion effect. What was the only difference? The only difference was that the researchers told the teachers that these students are special. These students are gifted. These students are different. So what changed? The way that the teachers treated, the way that the teachers dealt with those particular students changed. And it changed everything for that student. They did better on tests, they did better on exams, they did better on homework, they did better on classwork, they did better on everything. What about that young youth in your community? What about your child in your family? What about that person who you try to think and criticize? You will never do anything. You will never amount to anything. You will never become anything. That belief and those words will lead many times that child to become exactly what you are saying. And if you say a word of encouragement, a word of positivity, a word of saying you are gifted, a word of saying you are talented, a word of saying that of encouragement, you may find that it changes the entire paradigm of our youth and our next generation. Don't discourage people. Encourage them. How do we foster a strong next generation? How do we foster a strong community? How do we foster a strong society? One which believes truly in the belief system of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. How do we foster a strong community? Not in 5 or 10 years, but 100 years from now, 50 years from now, and so on and so forth, down the lines, to do two things which the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam focused on the most, which was what? Hifz al-Din. And hifz al-dima, that is the preservation of the faith and the preservation of the faithful. All of this is foundational on the basis of belief. The belief of the faith, the belief of the faithful. This is what the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. If you and I understand this and how powerful it is, we will encourage each and everyone to strive to understand the belief system of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, so we can cultivate in every individual. We're losing young ones, university students, college students. Many go off and their belief system begins to weaken. In some cases, and there are people who strengthen also, alhamdulillah. But there are others who lose it, their belief system. Not necessarily because of any other reason except for the environment. Maybe they have other priorities, or maybe perhaps someone has instilled doubt in their mind, or some doubt has emerged. Doubt is good, but doubt must be answered. And if doubt is not answered, it leads to uncertainty. Encourage and invite your family to delve into the sayings of the Ahlul Bayt to understand their belief system. You see, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, he had absolute certainty. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam and all of the Ahlul Bayt, they had absolute certainty, absolute tranquility, absolute certainty in what they believed. You and I must have absolute certainty, not necessarily in ourselves, but in their message and the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and ultimately in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in through that movement, we get confidence in ourselves and in our own belief system. What certainty did Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam have? What absolute understanding did Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam have? We are told in the land of Medina, as we take our hearts to Medina, that Walid has called on, based on the order of Yazid ibn Muawiyah, he has called upon Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam to give the bay'ah, to pledge allegiance to Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Trampling on the statement, trampling on the treaty, trampling on the agreement of Muawiyah and Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam, where the treaty said very clearly that Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam will get the leadership after Imam Hassan alayhi salam, but Muawiyah and Yazid after Muawiyah showed the true colors. At that point in time, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, he is called on to the governor's palace. And when he meets them at that moment, we're told in the middle of the night, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, he receives a summon. When he receives the summon at that point in time, they ask him, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, what is this? What have you been summoned at this time? He says, back to the messenger. He says to the messenger that I will perhaps come in the morning. Or he tells him that perhaps we do this in the day. When at that point in time you've been summoned. And the Imam alayhi salam, he responds to the Ahlul Bayt, I have been summoned to the palace. And at that point in time, Imam Hussein alayhi salam goes. When he gets there, we are told that he is asked to give the allegiance, that to pledge the allegiance. And when he is asked to pledge the allegiance, Imam says that why shall we do this now in the middle of the night, in the middle of the dark? Let the day break and we will see about this matter. The Imam alayhi salam, we are told the Banu Hashim are outside of the door. When they are outside of the door, the Imam has said that if my voice rises, at that point in time you enter. At that point in time, the enemy of Allah says that if Hussein leaves at this point in time in the middle of the night, you will never get bay'ah from him. Either sever his head or take the bay'ah, but don't let him leave. At that point in time, Imam raises his voice according to some narrations. The Banu Hashim, they enter. Ali Akbar, Abbas, the likes of these personalities enter. That who are you to strike even any moment and touch our master, our Mawla Sayyid al-Shuhada? They see the youth, the Shabab of Ahlul Bayt, and they all say, there is no way, we cannot take them at this moment. When the day breaks, the absolute certainty of Sayyid al-Shuhada Abdullah. We are told that the Imam makes the resolution to leave Medina. But what did he do before he leaves Medina? We are told he goes to the grave of Rasulullah, his grandfather Rasulullah. Imam al-Hussein falls onto the grave of Rasulullah. He says, my grandfather Rasulullah, take me into your grave. I want to be with you. Allah knows what Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam said to his grandfather. What is he saying? Because he knows he is being forced to leave the city of his grandfather, the Medina of his grandfather, the Medina of his childhood, of his home. At that point in time, when the day breaks, we're told the next day, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, he has made the resolution to leave Medina. When he has made the resolution to leave Medina, Medina, we are told that he calls upon the Shabab of Banu Hashim. He calls upon Ali Akbar. He calls upon Qasim. He calls upon Abu Fadl al-Abbas. And he says, Abbas, Qasim, Ali al-Akbar, go and get someone. Go and get your mothers. Go and get someone who is mahram to you. Go and get someone. Each person gets someone who is mahram to them. But there is one great lady, one esteemed lady. She is not, and she has not come towards the caravan. Who is it? Qasim ibn al-Hasan goes, and he comes back empty-handed. He says, I was not able to bring her. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam sees this. Ali al-Akbar goes, he is not able to bring this great esteemed lady back. Imam al-Husayn looks towards his companions and his household, his family. His eyes fall on Qamar Bani Hashim Abul Fadl al-Abbas. He says, Al-Abbas, go and get this great lady. Who is it? It is none other than Sayyida Zainab, the daughter of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Abu Fadl brings Zainab back. She comes to the caravan, but Zainab says, before I join, I have a wish, I have a desire. Zainab, what is it? She says, allow me to go to the grave of my mother Fatima al-Zahra. Allow me to go to the grave of my mother Fatima al-Zahra. Zainab goes to the grave of her mother Fatima. Allah knows what went through the heart of Zainab. She fell on the grave of Fatima al-Zahra. Allah knows what went through the heart and the mind of Zainab. My mother, I am leaving Medina. My mother, perhaps this is the moment my father told me about, that there may be a time where I am paraded in Kufa and Sham. Allah knows what went through the heart of Zainab. This was the tragedy and the calamity of Ali Muhammad. But I ask one final question, and I ask this question to Sayyid al-Shuhada. Ya Aba Abdullah, Sayyidi wa Mawlai, when they asked you to pledge allegiance, you raised your voice. The 18 moons of Banu Hashim entered, and they were there at your service. Sayyidi wa Mawlai, on the Asr of Ashura, there is no Qasim, there is no Ali Akbar, there is no Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Who is there for you to call? And Sayyida Zainab, this is Medina, there is Qasim and Akbar and Abbas. But come to Sham Ghariban, come to the night after Ashura. Who is there to come to your assistance?
أجركم الله والإمام الحسين decided to leave مدينة وكوفة. He went to visit the grave of his grandfather رسول الله. He would sit by that grave أجركم الله. He would tell his grandfather Rasulullah, oh my grandfather, I feel as if this world has become tight on my heart. He would tell him of all the troubles that he would be facing. He would tell his grandfather on everything that is happening, Ajarakumullah. And it's as if his grandfather would reply to him. He would say to him, oh Hussein, oh my beloved Hussein, Hussein. Oh, the one who is so dear to my heart. You will be leaving Medina now, but you will reach a place called Karbala. When you reach that place, I can see that Shimr would be sitting on your chest. I can see that you would be slaughtered on the plains of Karbala. I can see that the women will be taken as capturers. Allah has will to see them, to see you slaughtered, and Allah has will to see the women captive. ضمني عندك يا جده في هذا الضريح علني يا جد من بلوى زماني استريح ضاق بي يا جد من رحب الفضا كل فسيح فعسى طود الاسى يندك بين الدكتين فعلى من داخل القبر بكاء ونحيب ونداء بافتجاع يا حبيبي يا حسين ستذوق الموت ظلما ضاميا في كربلاء وستبقى في ثراها عاريا مندجلا وكأني بلئيم الأصل شمرها قد علا صدرك الطاهر بالسيف يحز الودجين هاجركم الله. He would be spending that night by the grave of his grandfather Rasulullah. When he would return, he would gather the people that he would take with him on his journey to Kufa. He would order Al-Abbas to prepare the caravan. He would be preparing the caravan. He would gather his women. He would gather his children. A few people from Medina would come to him. They would say to him, "Oh, Abu Abdullah, you are going towards Kufa. Why don't you go yourself? Why do you have to take your women with you? Why do you have to take your children with you?" He said to them, Allah has will to see me slaughtered, and he has will to see them as captives. He would gather them, but he would leave one of his daughters behind. Behind with who? With Umm al-Baneen, ajarakum Allah. He would leave this daughter of his who is ill, who was not feeling well, Fatima al-Alila. He would leave her in the city of Medina. She would come to him and she would tell him, "Oh my father, please take me with you." He says to her, "Oh my daughter Fatima, you are still young and you are tired, you are ill, and your body cannot take what is about to face us, ajarakumullah." Yes, we know what is about to face them. He would tell her, "Oh my beloved daughter, your body can't take what we are about to face, what we are about to face." وياكم اخذوني عقبكم والله يعمن عيوني قلها انت علي لو جسمك نحيل والله وعلى المثلك يا بويا السفر يا حرام. She would carry on and tell him, "Oh my beloved father," a poet beautifully describes this scene. "Oh my beloved father, take me with you. You said that my body can't take what is about to face us." Listen to these words. It's as if she turns around to her father. She would tell him, "I am like a nightingale singing alone for your return. Oh my beloved father Hussein, for your hugs I yearn. Oh my beloved father, oh my father, how is it fair? Ruqayya goes and I stay here. Why? I want to be there to stop them from ripping her. Oh my beloved father, why do you take Ali al-Asghar with you? I don't understand why you want to see his neck severed. Oh my beloved father, why do you take Ali al-Akbar with you? I don't understand why you want to see him in pieces.
صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا أمير المؤمنين صلى الله عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء سيدة النساء العالمين صلى الله عليك يا حسن المجتبى السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين
دمعي على الخدين حزنا أنها ما لباقر العلم مسلم لباقر العلم ولي مسلم حزنا وقفت وقفة الحائر حزناً وقفت وقفة الحائر أبكي وأجري مدمعاً ناظر لمسلم المظلوم